Hi guys, welcome back. This is Caitlin from grassfedgirl.com and we're here with Linda Salant from Salant. I already messed up. Oh my goodness. From The Carnitarian on Instagram. And she has been carnivore for a while and she's going to tell us her success story. And we're really excited to hear from her and all that she's learned and that you can take from that and apply it to your own journey. So welcome, Linda. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much for asking me to do this. This is great. I'm really happy to get the opportunity to discuss this with you.
Your first name's a lot easier than your last name for me.
Yeah. people get the first name right all the time.
I have an Aunt Linda, so that's easy. All right. So tell us how you got into carnivore and what made you want to do that. I mean, it's really counterculture. So it's not something easy to do without a lot of motivation. So what got you into it?
Yeah. So interestingly enough, like my story starts way back and I won't get into all, you know, the full details of it, but I had learned in a nutrition class back in college about the ketogenic, protein sparing ketogenic diet. And so I had known about that. That was way back in like 1993. And so when I graduated college, I started Atkins diet, which, you know, starts you out in a ketogenic state. And I had done that for a really long time.
Were you in a nutrition program or just?
I started out doing a double major in nutrition and in design. And then I quickly realized that the design classes it was a heavy load of design classes. And so I couldn't continue with nutrition, but I've always been interested in nutrition. And so the nutrition course that I took in college was basic. It was a basic intro to nutrition class, but my final paper was actually on that ketogenic diet. So I had been feeling really great doing Atkins for a while. As the years passed, took a few detours, fell into the calories in, calories out trap a bit. I started doing some, you know, heavy cardio stuff. And I did some crazy stuff like a Hollywood diet drink. And when I was not doing a low carb high fat diet, I realized I wasn't feeling so great. So I went back on that after my son was born. I went back on a low carb diet and ended up sticking with a ketogenic diet for about 3 months. But at some point, the stories of Kelly Hogan and Charlene Anderson popped up in my Facebook feed. And that was my introduction to the carnivore diet, where I thought, well, wow, you know, these ladies have really transformed. They look amazing. This is working for them. And I was pretty close to a carnivore diet. I was eating, you know, a ton of meat and all the low carb veg that goes along with that. So I said, well, maybe I'll just cut out the veg, do this for 30 days and see how I do. And it's been now almost 4.5 years. I have seen tremendous improvements just in that change of getting rid of vegetables and the nuts.
Don't tell anyone. When you tell people that, they like want to string you up.
I know, people think it's really very strange to not eat the veg, and you know, I'll order meat with a side of meat and people think I'm crazy.
Well, they must be shocked because, you know, to me, you look like all the women we have around here that, you know, are doing spin classes and drinking the yoga lifestyle or whatever. And it's like, if they only knew, you know, you don't eat like that.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. I mean, that's one of the great benefits of switching to a carnivore diet is that you can eat these amazing, delicious foods all the time until you're completely full. There's none of that bloat that's associated with eating those huge salads. I mean, I have eaten a ton of salad in my life. And when I don't order vegetables, people think, oh, you know, isn't that sort of childish and you don't like vegetables or, you know, whatever. And I love vegetables. I love the way they taste, but you know, my body does not love vegetables. I don't feel great after eating those. So yeah, cutting them out and sticking with carnivore is perfect for me.
So you didn't have, did you have any like really specific health concerns or just?
Well, you know, so for me, doing the ketogenic diet, being a low carb, high fat, having that way of eating was helpful in that I had a laundry list of health issues that I was just sort of living with that I didn't think were a big deal. You know, it's the kind of things that you just take a painkiller for, you know, put a cream on or, you know, whatever it is that they say, oh, well, you know, if you've got a headache, just, you know, take some Excedrin. But, you know, there were some major health improvements that surprised me that I'd been living with for a long time. And I didn't realize how not okay that was to be living with all that stuff. It seems the norm that when you know, hit your late 30s and 40s, you just have these things happening to you and you're just not feeling great. But switching to carnivore sort of like made me realize that, no, that stuff is not normal. I had been having major pain on the daily from interstitial cystitis and from daily migraines.
That's interesting because I have suffered for years with UTIs and stuff, and I never got like diagnosed, but people, I think that's the new thing, is they just say, oh, well, you have, I mean, that is just a chronic UTI, right?
So yeah, I mean, in a way it feels like that. It's pretty torturous. It feels like a chronic UTI, but if you go and get tested, they'll say, well, you know, there's white blood cells, but there doesn't seem to be any bacteria. So you're inflamed and there's a response there. And it's Sally Norton talks about this a bit, and it falls right into the low carb, high vegetable diet that I had been doing. All of those low carb vegetables, spinach, kale, broccoli, you know, all the brassica vegetables, the cruciferous stuff, and the nuts like almonds and peanuts that are staples of a keto diet.
Yeah, staple is my jam.
Yeah. And they can lead to a lot of inflammation and pain, and the oxalate content in those is what's really causing that, the bladder pain and the vulvar pain that comes with interstitial cystitis. So
what I had, you know, with all the UTIs, you know, if it was, because even now, sometimes if I get really stressed out, I feel like I'm getting a UTI, and I'm like, what the F, you know? And then I take a lot of essential oils and stuff, and I can usually, you know, get rid of it really quick. But it's also, I know, okay, well, I've been traveling, I'm dehydrated or I need a rest or whatever. Yeah. And so it's like, it's all connected, and I can like, it doesn't seem like it's just a bladder infection all the time, you know?
No, and it's not. And I completely hear you. When stress comes up, that pain can come back, you know, it's pretty debilitating, and, you know, makes you not want to get out of bed. It makes you not want to do anything. You certainly don't want to go work out with that kind of pain. So
you had headaches sometimes too, and you had interstitial cystitis. And what was the other thing?
Well, you know, another big, huge life-changing thing for me is the shift in the amount of swelling that I had in general, especially in my legs. Lipedema runs in my family, and it's called chronic venous insufficiency, where typically people will have varicose veins, they'll go have their veins removed. I had, you know, both the saphenous veins in both my legs removed because of the heavy legs and the pain in the legs and the swelling that comes in your leg. And it's, you know, people sometimes will call this like painful fat syndrome. And it makes it really hard to sit for long periods of time or to even roll over in bed. You find that you bruise really easily. And your legs just hurt. They're just in pain. And people say, well, is it your muscles? And it's not. It's literally the fat is so painful in the legs. And this diet, carnivore diet, combined with, you know, fasting, has minimized that pain in ways that it's truly life-changing. I can do things like I'll opt to take the stairs. And I mean, when I was in my 20s, I was searching for elevators. So not having that leg pain has been amazing, because when you're in pain daily from interstitial cystitis or from, you know, painful fat, it's depressing. And so I was like,
so it's kind of like an inflammation in your veins that's causing pain in all of your leg tissue.
So yeah, you end up with inflammation. Basically, the vein insufficiency is faulty valves. So your veins are having a hard time getting blood back to your heart. And that causes fluid buildup in your legs, varicose veins, and tons of swelling. And
I would think of that only with like really overweight people, or maybe like type 2 diabetics or something like that. Like you always hear about the feet pain, you know.
The neuropathy.
Yeah,
that comes with diabetes. Yeah. So I mean it is different than that, but I mean when you're overweight, that definitely puts pressure on your veins. And you can get similar leg pain to that.
Did you ever have a weight problem?
Sorry?
Did you ever have a weight problem?
No, you know, I was never overweight, never terribly overweight. I gained a ton of weight in my pregnancy, my first pregnancy. I was up, I won't even tell you the number. I was pretty up there in weight. And that just exacerbated my vein issues. And that's what drove, you know, my going to get treatment for the vein. But the issue for me was that I was always like a size 2 on top and a size 10 on the bottom. You can really tell, like, there's, you know, textural issues that come along with the lipedema, like I said, the bruising, and it's just this disproportionate distribution of fat, and it's uncomfortable, it's not attractive, and it's in itself, that is also kind of depressing. So
it kind of makes you not want to do anything, you know, like it makes you say, well, I don't want to go to the pool or the beach or just be active, you know, with your friends and stuff, probably, right?
Yeah. I mean, you're just feeling like not all that confident. So, you know, my go-to is always like a really long skirt and a tank top, because from the waist up, I'm like, you know, fit, but from the waist down, I was like a totally different person. So it's a very strange, not good thing, but this way of eating has helped tremendously. And I, you know, I was at the pool this summer and I'm playing outside in shorts with my kids. And so it's been great. It's very helpful. It's not perfect, but it's helpful.
So you're more proportional now with that?
Definitely. Yeah. I can fit into a dress without having to take in the top, you know, so I don't have to buy like a size 8 dress and then take the top, you know, the dress in and stuff like that. So yeah, definitely more proportional. That when you buy a dress, you know, meant for like perfect proportion. And so the hips on the dress now actually fit, which is kind of nice.
That's great. So tell us like a typical day of eating for you. What is your routine?
So, I intermittent fast. Just naturally, I fell into that sort of pattern because of my workout schedule. So I'll go dance in the morning, or I'll go to yoga in the morning, go lift. So I will eat starting at about 1 p.m. And then what I have typically is a ribeye steak as typical breakfast for me. And then later in the day, I'll have eggs, or I'll have, you know, bacon hamburger for dinner, or some other kind of meat. I'm sort of trying to vary the foods that I eat on a daily just for interest sake, and it makes for good Instagram content and stuff. So I've been incorporating more nose to tail and, you know, eating sort of delicious parts of animals that I hadn't been doing prior. But typically I'll eat, you know, people say like, how much do you eat in a day? And I figure I'm about, you know, 1.5 pounds of meat a day, and then, you know, add in some eggs, add in some extras. I will, you know, add in like some suet if I think my steak is too lean. That's pretty typical. You know, great things that I love to add are salmon roe and oxtail is like a huge new favorite for me, along with short ribs. And, you know, I've been trying like heart, I eat liver, I do raw liver, cooked liver, pate, stuff like that. So, I mean, typically I'm eating steak every day. But I also love lamb, I love salmon. So
now, have you ever done just like all beef?
So I never went that hardcore. I thought to myself, well, you know, I'll try this 30 days beef and water, like they say, just beef and water. And it just like wasn't working out for me. And there were people that were doing zero carb, you know, back in, what was it? It was 2015 when I started this. And, you know, they were saying, you know, you don't need to just do beef and water. You can do cheese, you can do eggs. And I said, okay, well, I'm more comfortable with that. So let's just stick with that. So I never did a strict beef and water. There have definitely been times where I've cut out cheese, you know, like just recently I cut cheese out for a few weeks just to try and make sure that I kept inflammation down, because I do see, you know, some swelling coming back if I go heavy on the cheese. So, and things like salami, if I'm eating too much salami, I will definitely see some swelling. So there's definitely benefit to just doing meat and water, but I've continuously incorporated, dairy, eggs, coffee and tea, and I haven't found them to be a huge problem. The minimal amount of inflammation that I get sort of keeps me in check and lets me know, you know, okay, that's enough with cheese sticks.
Oh man, that's my favorite. I can't buy those. So you are into ballroom dancing. Is that what it is?
I am. Yes, I do ballroom dance. It's like a dance sport. And I train twice a week. I go to the studio for, it's about an hour and a half each time. And then I compete once or twice a year in, you know, competitions and stuff. It's fun. It's a great stress reliever and a great way to get exercise without running on a treadmill. I can't run on a treadmill. It's just not for me.
Oh no. And I mean, I bet everyone there thinks you're weird what you eat, right?
Yes. So I just this weekend, I went to a competition. It is very funny because when they make the call, like, you know, they'll say, oh, the buffet is ready. You know, if you want to go out and get your lunch. And there's a huge proportion of that buffet table is raw vegetables. And I'm just like, oh, I hope I can find something down at the bottom for me. And so I, you know, I loaded my plate with, you know, a big portion of grilled chicken, and they had grilled salmon, which everybody was just putting on top of their salad. But I just grabbed three portions of it, put it on my plate. And everyone was like, really, lady? Like, you can't eat those vegetables. And, you know, same thing happens at dinner when it's like a table service dinner. You're served what everybody else has served. And so I just left all the veg on my plate and ate the filet. And then I even grabbed another filet off of another plate and I ate that. And people at the table thought that was pretty hilarious. But, you know, when people ask me, like, how long have you been doing this? And I tell them how long, then they're sort of like, oh, well, it seems to be working for you. So I don't share it with everybody. So I know that the reaction is kind of weird. Socially, it is a little bit awkward. And so if I'm at a party, I'll fast and I'll say, oh, I already ate, you know, but I don't generally, if somebody says, oh, aren't you eating? You know, I don't generally say, oh, well, no, I'm carnivore and I don't eat this kind of stuff. I'll just sort of be like, I'm fine. I don't need it. You know, I'm not hungry or whatever, and avoid it that way.
I usually will say like I'm low carb or something, because it'll just, they usually know what that is, and then they don't get too freaked out, you know. So I mean, I don't want to feel like starting a fight with everybody, you know.
Right. It gets tough, because especially now, I mean, everybody's mind is, you know, climate change and the cows, and you're destroying the planet by being a meat eater. And so it really is a touchy topic for a lot of people. And you never know when you walk into a room and you meet new people, what their stance is on eating meat. And it can,
and they're going to be vegetarian. I mean, there's a lot of vegetarians and they're going to get their claws out.
That's right. So I try to avoid that. And, you know, I just try to avoid it because a lot of people in that the vegetarian and vegan space can be, you know, very passionate. And I think they all believe that they're doing the right thing. You know, I do. I think there's a little bit of misinformation driving that, but
I'm sure that, I mean, I was a vegetarian. I don't know if you ever were, but I thought I was doing the right thing until I got really, really, really sick and I couldn't even get out of bed. So
horrible.
It sounds like a good idea.
It does. That's the thing. It sounds like a really good idea. It sounds like it's great. Like it's cruelty free. It's so healthy and it's so natural. And of course it makes sense because you don't want to hurt animals. Right. But
you're supposed to die in the process.
Right. So that it's tough, you know, it's tough. So I try to avoid conversation about that. But you know, when like you found out that, you know, eating meat, it's good for you. And it's not such a terrible thing. And I hope that people will, you know, come around and make a full circle on this and realize that just eating meat, if that's what works for you, then that's what you should do. I mean, I'm not super strict about what other people do, and I'm not going to yell at anybody for eating vegetables. But, you know, there is an argument to be made there for the environment. Eating meat as is good for the environment, you know, and is also minimizing, you know, death in agriculture and stuff like that. We can get into later, but it's not, you know, all like unicorns and rainbows when you're just eating vegetables. Oh, there's reality there. And even though you don't see the death on your plate, it's there.
Yeah. So especially then you add in bringing quinoa from South America or whatever. It's like, it's not a carbon neutral thing just because you think it is.
That's right. This is like a huge pet peeve of mine. When you see, you know, vegan activists flying across the globe to talk about how being vegan is so great for the environment. And I'm thinking, well, how many airplane rides have you been on this year? You know, how many acai bowls have you eaten? And those, you know, goji berries that are shipped from Asia. And, you know,
yeah, you think that coconut oil is from Florida? Probably not.
Right. It blows me away how, I mean, it's just, you know, you can easily ignore things that you choose to ignore. And it is very powerful propaganda. The vegetarian and the vegan propaganda is really very powerful. And it does convince you that it's the right thing for you, for the planet, you know, for the environment in general. But I think that if, from what I've learned, if you're vegan, you can be strict, but at about a 4 or 5 year mark, you just kind of start falling apart as a vegan, unless you're cheating, you know, which I think the long-term vegans maybe aren't being completely honest. It only takes just a little bit of animal foods to pull you out of that. So, you know, you cheat a little bit, you just stay vegan, but not really. And pretend that, you know, long-term lifelong veganism is going to work, but you're just not.
I've seen what it means. The videos where they say, I was watching one the other day and the girl was saying, well, I would just only film on the days when I didn't have like circles under my eyes. And, you know, on the days I felt okay, it's like, well, yeah, I mean, I put on makeup, but it's not like, but I usually feel okay most of the time.
Yeah. I mean, right. It's just, you know, it's not the greatest way to eat, in my opinion.
Now, do you stress about your, you know, sourcing and grass-fed beef and stuff like that?
So I personally don't stress out about it. I am, you know, a huge fan of regenerative agriculture, and I'm a huge fan of eating grass-fed if you can afford it. But I think that what people really should focus on is a meat-based diet that gets them healthy or keeps them healthy, keeps them from, you know, becoming part of the prescription society, you know, and staying out of the doctor's office. So I think if you're eating conventionally raised beef and conventionally raised eggs, you're pretty much, you're 100% of the way there in terms of being able to regain your health or maintain your health. If you've got the budget and you can do grass-fed, like, go for it. I think that that's amazing, because it's great for you. I think there's an incremental benefit to eating grass-fed fat, animal fat versus grain-fed animal fat. But I think that the major benefit just comes from switching from a standard American diet to a meat-based diet. The rest is just, you know, like they say, gravy on the top. So I don't stress out about it. I have found that, you know, when, if I'm eating a pound and a half of meat a day, I can't spend $25 a pound. And I love ribeye. So, you know, grass-fed ribeye from the specialty market is going to cost me $27 a pound. I can't do that every day. Yeah. it's just too much. So I've been getting, my favorite ribeye comes from my local supermarket. It's conventionally raised. So it's grass fed until it's grain finished, right? Because all beef is grass fed at the start. So I don't stress out about the grass finishing. I'm with Sean Baker on this. I think you need to do as good as you can do. And, you know, if you're worried about your carbon footprint, then I would say, you know, skip that flight, you know, don't take that flight that you were going to take, or don't drive across country.
An electric car or something.
Yeah, right. Because that's where really where like the emissions are coming from.
I have a Prius, so hey, I'm good.
Right, good. That's awesome. That's great.
And I mean, I eat a lot of ground beef that's grass fed. That's mostly what I buy grass fed, and that's mostly what I eat. You know, and I do buy pastured eggs too, because they're not that much more, you know, but yeah, when it comes to big steaks, they are freaking expensive. And I will buy, like you said, oxtail from the farmer, stuff that's kind of weird. You can't even find it at the regular grocery store. So, I mean, I'll buy, you know, chicken feed and oxtail and liver from the farmer because it's pretty cheap from him anyway, because nobody else buys it, you know, like yes, most people buy, amazing. They buy some of it, you know, but it's not, you just can't even find it unless you go, you know, to the farmer. But then on the same token, his grass-fed beef is gross because it's so lean, you know? So like I'll buy that from another place because it's just too lean, and because that's what people want. And it's like, I can't eat this. It's gross.
I know it. I'm with you on that. And that's, you know, one of the reasons too, while I'll just eat the conventionally raised beef is because it just tastes better to me. You know, I don't like the look of a this beautiful picture perfect red steak with no white. It's like, that's not what, I don't enjoy that. So,
I mean, I didn't buy like we bought a whole cow before many times, and, you know, you end up, I actually have a whole lot of it right now because it's so lean that I have to wait. I'm going to wait till the winter when I can do the roasts, the stews and the roasts, and, you know, put it in my Instant Pot, because right now it's still hot and I don't want to eat that, you know, but in the winter I can make it into, you know, slow cooked beef and stuff. And then, and my husband will eat it too, like that, if I put, he eats vegetables, so I'll put like low carb vegetables in like a Instant Pot, and then I'll eat the stew part, and he'll eat the you know, the like what is it called? Like a pot roast, you know?
Right.
And so like, and I've been making jerky with that. It's just like so lean, you know, it's like, what am I supposed to do?
That's perfect. Yeah. Jerky's perfect for that. I mean, yeah, that's a great way to use up a lean cut.
And, okay. So now this is something interesting, because I think you're the longest carnivore person I've talked to. So what did you see improvements? Like, I'm interested in if after 1 year, you know, did you see an improvement that over 2 years, 3 years, you know what I mean? Like from the beginning, like people always see the drastic benefit in the beginning, but then later, did you see more benefits or did it level off? Yeah.
I've actually been seeing cumulative benefit. It's getting better every year, which is, you know, it was kind of unexpected. I'll be honest with you. When I started and in years, you know, the first 3 years, I would say like, oh, you know what? I'm just feeling kind of snackish. Let me just grab these peanuts. It's no big deal. I'm still carnivore. I'm going to eat these nuts. And it wasn't until recently that I cut out any of that. Like, you know, if once a month I grabbed a handful of like pistachios or something, I thought it wasn't going to do any harm or whatever, but it turns out it actually does. I end up getting like an eczema flare if I, you know, grab a handful of peanuts. And I said, oh my gosh, I had no idea that I was allergic to this stuff, you know, because it's just this minor thing that you just sort of live with. But I saw improvements on carnivore diet right away, especially with my menstrual cycle. It was within 3 months of switching to carnivore, the PCOS that I'd been experiencing my entire life just resolved. I would go for 6 months without a period. And once I switched to carnivore, I am so regular now. It's amazing. But the benefits that I'm seeing as the years go by to things like the painful fat, swelling, and just strength gains is consistently improving, you know, as the months and the years go by. So, I mean, right now I'm in the best shape I've been in since I was in my 20s. I'm in the best shape, you know, as far as cardio, strength, just having the motivation to get up out of bed, not feeling that daily anxiety, that depression. Even doing this interview with you, I never would have done this years ago because the social anxiety was just crazy. I mean, I don't know how vegetables do it, but for me, it was a little bit like debilitating thinking of going to a party, meeting new people, talking to people. I would just cancel plans. And I just don't do that anymore. As the years go by, I find myself more and more and more mellow.
That's probably, I mean, a gut healing, you know, that's happened over time. You know, you have more feel good hormones or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Now you're,
that's interesting because, well, I mean, I think I can notice that I have a family member who's just started carnivore like 3 weeks ago. And I mean, I'm going to talk more about it if they stick with it, but I don't want to jinx it, you know, but I can tell already, like when that person answers the phone, they're like, hi, and I'm like, who is this? You know? You know, so
instead
you
of not picking up the phone at all.
Yeah. Or just like their voice has changed, their mood has changed. And of course now they're calling me to eat steaks and stuff. And I'm like, this is great. I have a new steak buddy.
It is. It's really, really great. And I've found more comfort in the past year in realizing that so many people are doing this. Like I thought this was just like a fringe Facebook group of people that, you know, I had been in contact with for years, but it was January of this year, maybe it was December last year that I got on Instagram and I said, oh my gosh, I had no idea that there was this many people. And that there was so much support for carnivore diet. And so I've been feeling a little bit more open about sharing it with my friends. Like I said, I don't tell like, you know, strangers and stuff, but I've been able to like admit to my friends, like the reason I'm not eating your vegetable dish or whatever at your party. And I think that they've heard about it and they're sort of like, oh, okay. You know, so as the years go by, I'm more comfortable with that as more people learn that, you know, people are doing it. I think it was, there was a huge breakthrough when Sean Baker went on Joe Rogan, right? It was just tons of people found out about the diet then. And so I think that was like amazing to get all of the people who hadn't heard about it. I opened up to a huge audience. So I think it's great. I think a lot of people are finding a lot of health benefits from it. And it's not just like this weird Facebook group of people anymore.
Well, I remember when, I mean, I've been paleo since like 2010 and it was that because I remember that Charlene Charlene and Joe.
Joe and Charlene, they're awesome.
That blog post that went around, and I was like, those people are nuts.
And right.
I mean, I was just like, oh, hell no, I'm never doing that. They're crazy. And I mean, yeah, they looked normal, but I was just like, no way, that's too much, you know?
It is. It's sort of like an unbelievable tale, right?
And I was like, I've already cut everything. I can't go anymore, you know? and of course, I believe vegetables were so good for me, even though I was constipated and bloated all the time, 24/7. Aww. Like miserable. So I just kept shoving them in.
it's so sad, but that's what people do. I mean, I've had people say to me like, well, how do you go to the bathroom? You know, like I can't go to the bathroom unless I eat vegetables. And
if I do eat vegetables.
Right. So yeah. So it's a different mindset. And it's like, you have to sort of suspend everything you've been taught. All of the good, you know, supposed good research says that vegetables are good for us. That eating meat is bad for us. Eating meat is going to clog your arteries, block your colon, give you cancer, you kill the planet. And once you really get into the science of it, and I've spent so much time in the space, I mean, the thousands of conversations that really smart people in the carnivore space have been having, it's so helpful to have that in your back pocket to know that I'm going to be fine. My, you know, high total cholesterol is not going to kill me, you know, and I'm not going to get cancer. I'm not going to die. I'm not going to kill the planet. Knowing those facts really changes it, and it messes with your head at first, but it can really change how you feel about what you should be eating.
Well, knowing that a lot of the climate facts are skewed or manipulated, or that it's really only like 3% or something comes from the cows. Right. And it's really, I mean, they even had Elizabeth Warren the other day saying, we're not going to take away your hamburgers because industry wants us to believe. This is what she was saying. Like, they want to trick us into thinking that it's not from industry, that it's from hamburgers. And it's like, that's not, you know, and I mean, I'm just quoting her, but I was like, that's awesome that she's not falling for it, you know? And,
right. I think it's pretty awesome too, because it is, I mean, 70% comes from transportation and, you know, production of electricity, mm-hmm. and the buildings. And
yeah, I mean,
not the cheeseburgers.
Coal and all this stuff that we don't even have to have. I mean, anyway, we're not going to get all political or anything.
Right.
And I'm not saying like, I mean, I agree with everything about Elizabeth Warren or anything at all, but I just think it was cool because so many of the people like are into the Green New Deal, and it's just like, oh, let's just take away your hamburgers. That'll solve everything. And it's like, that's not the biggest problem, you know? So I like if somebody's thinking independently. What about like, let's talk about keto flu and like electrolytes. What do you do? And cravings too, that during that period.
So, you know, keto flu.
Remember?
So sorry, yeah, it was a while ago, right?
Yeah.
And because I had been coming from a low carb diet, I didn't have tremendous keto flu. I mean, I was never a sweets person. I was never a sugar addict. And I really feel for those people who've gotten themselves into a situation where they're diabetic, they're pre-diabetic, they're hooked on sweets, they know they need to make this change, and they try, and that first week or two or four is like torture. That keto flu is withdrawal, you know? I mean, you can have all the salts and make sure you get your potassium salt, make sure you get your sodium and your magnesium, and that can help alleviate some keto flu symptoms. But really, your brain is just screaming for sugar. It's tough. So I didn't have that kind of withdrawal. But I, you know, I feel really bad for people who've had to go through that. And I'm sorry, what was the second half of your?
Well, just like now, what do you do about electrolytes now or during when you started? Okay,
so generally during the day and on the daily, I heavily salt my food. I use a lot of salt on steaks, just regular sodium. And then if I get a headache, if I randomly have a headache, I'll drink some potassium. Funny thing I do is I like to eat buttered eggs, which is like a hard boiled egg that I smear some butter on top and I eat that. And whenever I eat buttered eggs, I will shake on potassium salt. Like that's my topping for the butter. So I get like, a little potassium that way.
That like a light salt or what is?
It is. So potassium salt is a salt substitute, something like Morton's No Salt. There's another one called Light Salt. It's potassium chloride instead of sodium chloride. So you can buy it in a supermarket right next to the salt. And so it's, you know, I mean, it's one of those important electrolytes. Yeah.
This morning, somebody from India was asking me about that. And I was like, well, do you have Morton's Light Salt? And he's like, I don't know.
It's not available everywhere. Yeah. I didn't know that.
Cheapest thing I can recommend for you, you know, like, I don't really use that. I just use Redmond because I feel like, well, I hate the taste of that light salt. It's so gross to me. I mean, if you put it in some food, you won't really notice it, but to put it straight in your mouth or something, or even in water, I mean, I can like put it in a little bit and then like shoot it kind of like in a little bit.
That's a good way to do it.
Mm-hmm. Mix it and then kind of shoot it. But I just hate like sipping on it. It's like, ugh.
No, it's not. It does not make a good sipper. It's definitely, you do it like I'll take some. If I'm feeling like I've got a headache, I'll shake some in the palm of my hand and just lick it off and take it like medicine. And then, you know, drink some coffee and, you know, get that taste out of my mouth. It definitely does not taste good. I find less and less that I've had to take like magnesium at night. I supplement sometimes with it's a supplement called Mega Mag. It's like a liquid magnesium, mix that with water. It also tastes really terrible. So I'll just shoot it at night. And that if I have any leg cramps or anything, that takes care of it right away.
Okay.
But typically the only time I'm like really thinking about supplementing with electrolytes, because I do the salting automatically, you know, put the potassium on my eggs automatically, is if I'm fasting. And then I will, you know, do a mix of sodium and potassium. And just sort of drink that throughout the day.
So when did you start the fasting?
It's been, you know, I've done shorter fasts, started last year.
You didn't do that at first?
No, I definitely didn't do that at first. You know, just I thought going for more than 5 hours without food would be just terrible. And I thought it was sort of like, what's the word I'm looking for? Sort of self-hating to do that to yourself. Like, why are you torturing yourself? You're hungry. You know, you should eat. Like, that's not okay. But okay. But then the more I read about it, I said, well, there's reasons why this is an eons long practice. People do fasting, and it is actually pretty therapeutic. So, I started with intermittent fasting and just, you know, having an eating window. And then I said, well, let me see if I can do, you know, 2 days. And I did, and it wasn't fun. But I eventually worked my way up. I did, this year was the first time I did a super long extended. I did a 7-day water fast, and it was tremendous in terms of helping with that painful fat, because although, you know, carnivore was helping with, you know, reduction of swelling, the fat that was in my legs really wasn't going anywhere. So that was just lingering. And with fasting, with the extended fasting, that fat went, and I was surprised. But, you know, I thought to myself, if anything is going to get this gone, it's going to be that. And it really did help. So I've done a few extended fasts this year, 7-day, 5-day. And I think what I'm going to do is just keep it quarterly. I don't think extended fasting consistently is good for anybody. So intermittent fasting, I think, you know, do that daily. But an extended fast like that, you really wouldn't want to do more than, you know, 4 times a year, at least for me.
Well, and I think that's I mean, cool that you said you didn't start out doing it, because what I worry about, and especially in, I'm in the women's carnivore group in Facebook. It's like, I don't know if you're in that one.
But I am. I see you in there.
They're very pro fasting, it seems like. And I mean, people are saying their first month of carnivore, they're trying to do extended fasting. And I'm just like, I feel like what you're sounding like you're doing, you started it after doing carnivore for several years. I mean, I just feel like, you know, we're a perfectionistic society. A lot of women, there is a connection between women having autoimmune disease and being perfectionistic, and, you know, A type people. And I'm sure you have heard about this before, but it's like this, of course, not eating is going to, you know, it's like a contest. Who can do it longer? Who can do it better? I mean, we've been dieting our whole lives. Of course, we're going to be addicted to it. You know, I mean, I think what you're doing is totally different. I think that's a different thing. You've thought about it a long time. You adapted. You have an issue you're trying to deal with. You know, that's more like Michaela Peterson does it now, but I don't think she did that at first either. She didn't even start fasting till like after a year or something. And I mean, I don't mean intermittent fasting. Like, I do intermittent fasting because I don't even think about it. Like, I haven't eaten anything yet. It's 11 o'clock almost, you know, I could go till 1 or 2, or I could eat at 10. I mean, it's just totally depends on what I'm doing
Great.
But I just feel like it's almost like you get a high from it. Everybody knows that, right? And so it's
you get a little like, life is great. I end up having conversations with people like at the supermarket. I would never just go up to somebody and start talking to them. When I'm fasting, I'm super chatty.
Well, you can't eat, so you have nothing else to do.
buying food for everybody else.
Yeah, but you know what I'm saying? Like, it's almost like they get into this, like, oh, well, I fasted for this many days, or, you know, it's just almost like a pissing like a contest or something.
Yeah, and it's just, I agree with you. It's just not a healthy way to approach fasting, because, you know, you have to really listen. Everybody says, this is you really have to listen. You have to say, like, you know, am I going to stress my body out by doing another fast just because I want to tell somebody I did it? You know, that's not helpful. That doesn't heal anything.
What is the motivation? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's sometimes, and people think, and people also think, which I think is a misnomer, that right when you go from carnivore or from keto, that carnivore is the same thing, and that you can just, since you're used to being keto, you can just go right into fasting because you're already keto.
Right. That I have found that is just not true. Also, I've found the same thing. I think what drives the complication there are the keto sweets and that addiction to, like, you know, like keto mug cakes and fat bombs and things that have artificial sweetener in them. You're still going to get that, you know, crazy. Like, I need to have like a keto sweet. And if you're trying to fast, that's really tough. So even though you're fat adapted, you're still addicted to sweet, and fasting is harder. So I think, you know, I recommend to anybody who asks, first thing you need to do is get fat adapted, go keto. If you want to do fasting, you know, get fat adapted. But the second thing you need to do is get rid of all the sweet stuff. And that's the hardest one, like getting rid of the diet soda, getting rid of artificial sweeteners, is going to tremendously help with fasting.
I mean, I could never do keto. I mean, on keto, I was always like, carnivore helped me with that. I never got off the sweets when I was on keto, because I was always like, oh, well, this person says it's okay, and this person says it's okay, so why not? I mean, I'm just having a little stevia and a little bit. I mainly ate stevia. I didn't eat a lot of erythritol and stuff, because that would give me a stomach ache if I ate a lot of it, or if I cooked something, because of course I'd eat the whole, you know, pan or whatever.
Yeah, it just goes, just disappears.
Yeah. I don't know what happened to it, but, so yeah, the going carnivore was the only way that I ever got off the sweeteners, and it helped so much. I mean, I have not had, I mean, only once or twice, like on special occasions, I've had a few little treats or something, but not, it's out of my everyday life completely. And I don't think about it. And I don't eat chocolate anymore. I mean, I had to have chocolate. I mean, I almost wanted breakfast chocolate, you know, it was like, I had to have it three times a day. You know, it was like, I think I'm addicted to the caffeine in it or something, or the something in it. But I feel like going carnivore is a way to really get rid of all that sweet tooth stuff.
Absolutely. I mean, it is, it's like the ultimate elimination diet. So if you're having cravings in any way, if you switch to just meat and water, all your cravings are going to go away. And then you can start adding back in and see what you tolerate and see what's causing you issues. You know, it's like, you won't know if it's the asparagus, broccoli, or the peanuts or the chocolate that are giving you these cravings until and then put one back at a time.
Yeah, the flax seeds, the chia, the almond flour. I mean, so how do you deal with balancing out with your family and stuff?
Well, so I've got two kids, a teenage girl and a six-year-old boy. And my daughter is, you know, only slightly interested in what I'm doing diet-wise. She thinks it's very strange. And she doesn't, you know, criticize me about it because she knows this is just what I do, but she still thinks it's kind of strange and thinks that it would be a very strange thing for her to take on. So she's not all that interested. My six-year-old is very interested in being very strong. You know, we talk about strong food. So he wants to eat the meat. Like last night he asked for shrimp for dinner because it's a strong food. And so I am so happy when he asks me for a bite of my steak, but he's always ordering hamburger. And my husband for a while did carnivore with me. He's a huge fan of salad and he doesn't have any issues with eating salad. He doesn't get like the gastrointestinal distress that I would. So he'll sit down before dinner and eat a huge salad and then he'll eat the carnivore meal that I'm eating, you know? So with family, it's sort of just the status quo right now is that, you know, mommy likes meat. That's what I eat. If you ask my son, like, what's my favorite food? He'll tell you it's steak, it's meat, just steak and meat. And what I have found great is that when we have friends over and, you know, now they are accepting of that I only eat meat and they love that I cook for them. And so we can have these big parties and have all our friends over and they know that they're going to get cooked like a super delicious steak or some rinse or some carnitas or something delicious. So being able to work out the social aspect of it, the family aspect of it has been working out really well lately.
That's good. So do your kids, are they a little more, do you have a hard time feeding them like junky stuff? Like, are they a little more? I'm sure you can't control when they're outside, you know, but.
That's exactly it. So it is very hard. I mean, I think if you're homeschooling, it's a lot easier to control your kids' food, right? But what happens for me is that, you know, I try to pack my son's lunch and then he goes to school and he sees, you know, the kid sitting next to him has got a snack pack and a gummy pack and, you know, a quesadilla or whatever for lunch. And so I have a really hard time fighting that fight every day. There's also birthday parties every weekend where it seems like just a big sugar fest for kids. And that's the norm. And that's what we do and accept it. Oh, it's fun. It's for kids. And so it's hard to tell them, you know, don't have the cake, don't eat the candy because it's part of the celebration for them. So I do have a hard time with it. I don't keep sugar in the house. So he's not getting gummy vitamins or anything like that. He's not getting fruit snacks from me. But when he goes to school, I find out later in the day, like, oh, they had morning snack and it was a cup of applesauce or it was a cup of mango in juice, you know, chopped up mango in juice. And I'm like, oh, okay, you know what? There's only so much I can do. So I try and be an example for them at home. And at home, I keep the meals sort of low carb. My son is a big fan of macaroni and cheese. So I make it for him. Just trying to keep some normalcy in his life. And then, you know, when he's an adult, he can choose if he's having.
Well, I think as long as you try, I mean, anything you do is going to be better than probably the way, I mean, I don't know about you, but the way I grew up on, you know, anything you do is going to be an improvement. So.
Yes. I can't believe I'm even still alive with the things that I grew up on. Amazing.
The margarine and just that alone was every day on the table. Like,
Yeah, margarine, Entenmann's every night for me. You know, that was, we would have, you know, a typical American dinner growing up was the three things on the plate, the vegetable, the meat, and the potato. And my mom's a great cook and she can make an amazing good lasagna. Like, I mean, it is hard to not eat that stuff. We ate a ton of, you know, not so healthy foods. And there was dessert after every dinner. It was just part of dinner. You would sit down and have dessert. And I try to run my table a little bit differently, but it doesn't always work out because somebody's always having a birthday and you know, there's always a party to go to and candy there and cake and stuff.
I think you just have to, my sister has two small kids and, you know, so it's the same thing. She just tries to feed them as good as she can at home and then just hope for the best the rest of the time because, you know, you can't make them live in a bubble. So
right, that's the thing. It's really hard. You know, not everybody is on board with this. And if you try to convince, you know, parents like to serve, you know, low carb foods at a birthday party, I don't think you get invited next time.
Yeah, they're like that person. There was a woman, and when I was a kid, like she didn't feed her kid sugar. Like she went to our church, and everybody was like, "She's weird." You know, it's like right. Okay. Well,
you don't want to be that house, you know, at Halloween that doesn't give out candy.
So what do you see long term for yourself with this diet, and what do you want to try next, or what are you doing next?
I mean, I feel like I've sort of found my pocket. I think I'm just going to sit here for a while. I mean, for the duration. You know, I feel great. I feel healthier than ever and stronger than ever. You know, my goal is to be as strong as a 20-year-old, you know, when I'm retired, and I want to go surfing. I want to dance. I want to do those things that when, you know, people say, oh, I'm too old for this now. I can't get around. I don't ever want that to be me. You know? So I want to be that example for my kids to say, you know, painful aging and is not normal. You know, all of this diseases of age is not normal. And having 7 prescriptions in your bathroom is not normal. Like, we shouldn't accept that. And if you staying carnivore is a little socially awkward, fine. You know, I'm just going to stick with it because it works for me. And I'm just hoping for, you know, enduring strength and longevity, and that I can enjoy myself until, you know, hopefully the end for me, I'm just going to just go in my sleep. I'm going to be dancing the day before, and then I'll just be gone one day. I don't want to live a life of, you know, hospital visits and doctor visits and prescription. And so for me, I think this is it for me. I'll continue doing seasonal extended fasting and, you know, intermittent fasting. It's just great for, you know, my energy levels. I find that I can, you know, work out better in the mornings if I stick with that. So I'm just going to keep doing what I'm doing. It seems to be working really well. I'm happy sort of sticking with this. I think that the next thing for me is just more of the same, but, you know, I'd like to, you know, just be a voice to help people, give people confidence that this is okay. This is okay for you. It's okay for the planet. And you know, give it a try. If you haven't tried a meat-based diet before, I mean, if you've got any sort of issues, gastrointestinal issues, leaky gut, like you said, it's worth trying. I mean, all that we've been told about the necessity of fiber, vegetables and stuff, is just, you know, it's hurting a lot of people. And the idea of eating 5, 6, 7 meals a day is hurting a lot of people. So you know, hopefully I'll just be able to, you know, reach some people in the future, but I'm just going to keep on doing what I do.
So That sounds awesome. I mean, and you look amazing and your skin is amazing. I mean,
you're so sweet. Thank you. You look amazing as well.
Thank you. You said you're over 40, but I don't believe it.
So. It's true. I won't give you my age, but yes, I am definitely headed towards mid 40.
Wow. That's amazing. So everybody go follow Linda over at the Carnitarian on Instagram.
That's right.
You can comment and leave her a message there. And below, let us know what you think about this interview. It's really been fun to talk and get to know you, Linda. It's
been so great. Thank you.
And I'm so glad you're over your social anxiety. And so guys, just leave us a comment below, like this video, please subscribe, share it with a friend, and we'll see you next time. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Take care.
All right. Bye.